Good morning, 12th. Hey, we're so glad you're here. We long to become a biblical community of kingdom people that are joining God and the restoration of all things, one person, one place at a time. So that's what we're about here at 12th today and every day. My name is Jordan. Just a few quick announcements as we get going. The first is Trivia Night is coming up. I know we have been talking about this a lot. We have 10 teams registered. You've done a great job. We're looking for 5 to 6 more over the next couple of weeks. And so if you are interested in signing up your 6-person team, you can do it at the QR code right there. There's going to be lots of giveaways. Dynamic Disc has already signed on for our grand prize, which is going to be free tickets to the DDO, some free merchandise, a tour of the headquarters. It's going to be really great. So please sign up. It's for a good cause. We're going to try and take a record number of 7th through 12th graders to Super Summer this year in July, which is our summer camp that we do for a week at Camp Webster in Salina. And so would really love to have all the support we can for that. So please come to Trivia Night. It's going to be a blast. It's going to be a great way to support our students. So invite you to that. Want you to be a part of it with us. Also, about 12 hours after Trivia Night, maybe even less, we're going to flip this room because If Gathering is happening in the exact same space the next morning. If Gathering is for women. Our team went down and saw it live in Texas, and now they're going to live stream it here that day, that Saturday. And so they're inviting you to it. If you would like to sign up on the QR, you can do it there. You can also sign up at the back with my wife, Katie, right there. So she's got to sign up, too, if you'd rather do it pen and paper. And there are also cards to invite friends if you want to invite people as well. So we're excited about If Gathering. I believe the ladies last week told us that high school girls and college girls get in free. And so if you are interested in that, that's a little promo for you. We want you to be a part of it. And then last but certainly not least, next week is going to be Easter Sunday. We're excited. If you're new here and haven't done Easter with us before, know that we do a 7:30 sunrise service. So if you want to join us for that, you can. We do a really good breakfast afterwards. And then our two services are at the normal times of 9:15 and 11. So that is what I've got for you guys. Would you stand? We're going to pray and get to worship. Let's pray. Father, we're so grateful for your spirit in this place. We're so grateful that you are a spirit of freedom, that you give us your spirit of freedom when we allow you into our lives. Jesus, my natural inclination is to hold on tightly to my life and to try and control things and to try and schedule every little thing. And you are so the opposite. In you, there is freedom in giving you control. In you, there is freedom when things don't have to go my way because my life is about something bigger than me. It's about you and what you've done for us. And so, Jesus, I just pray that spirit of freedom over this group right now. If anyone in here is like me where they tend to hold tightly to things and have to have their way in things, would we just have the ability by your spirit to release those things now? Jesus, could we make you the center of this morning? Could we make you the center of our lives going out from here? That we would be people marked not by what we want, but what you are doing through us and in this world. Jesus, we thank you that we get to gather and be your body this morning. We thank you for the worship. We thank you that worship is not only pleasing to your ears, but it is so good for our hearts as well to remind us of who we are in you. We lift up Garen and the word he's going to bring and just pray that your spirit would make it more than a speech, that it would be more than a reading of a text, that it would be life injected into our hearts. Lord, we love you. You are the source of truth. There's lots of places in the world we can get opinions, and there's lots of places we can get subjective truths, but Lord, you are the capital T truth, and we're so just humbled and honored and excited to plug into you this morning. So would you be with us in this space? Would you enlighten our hearts and eyes and ears so that we can learn and see and hear new things that we couldn't before? So we give this time to you. We invite you in. We just submit ourselves to you. We tell you that it's all for you because you're so good to us. It's in your son's name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Good morning. This is Palm Sunday. We're getting into Holy Week leading up to the celebration of Easter and the Resurrection Sunday next week. So I wanted to read Zechariah 9:9. Talks about the king coming. So rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout aloud, O daughter of Jerusalem. Behold, your king is coming to you, righteous and having salvation, humble and mounted on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey. So we're going to be worshiping our King Jesus and exalting him over everything. So let's bring our thanks and our praise to him this morning and just focus on Jesus.
Heaven. the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is amazing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life. That I would be set free. Whoa.
Into a moment of prayer where we come to the Lord this morning and we just want to lay things down at His feet. Holy Spirit, will you show us if there's anything that you want us to lay down this morning, anything that we've been carrying you don't want us to have to carry? Maybe there's been some unmet expectations where we expected you to come through in a certain way, or we expected you to show up in a certain time, and that didn't happen. Lord, we lay these things down at your feet, Jesus. And we say that you are King of kings and Lord of lords. Take your place as rightful king in our hearts this morning. Forgive us for our sins. The things that we've done we shouldn't have, the things that we have left undone that we should have done. Wash us clean again. Will you just plead your blood over us again? You are the one that sets us free. You cleanse, you forgive, you heal, and you restore. No one else died for us but you, Jesus. And so we lift up your name. We sing, worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive all glory and honor and power and dominion, now and forever. Amen. Let's sing that one more time. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. And worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy.
Before I spoke a word, you were singing over me. You have been so, so good to me. Before I took a breath, you breathed your life in me. You have been so, so kind. But still you give yourself away. And all the overwhelming, never ending, reckless love of God. Yeah, yeah. Still your love fought for me. You have been so, so good to me. When I felt no worth, you paid it all for me.
Just tell him this morning
that you have been so, so kind to me. And all the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Oh, it chases me down, fights till I'm found, leaves the 99. I couldn't earn it, I don't deserve it, but still you give yourself away. Love of God, yeah. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. Oh, the overwhelming, never ending, reckless love of God. Oh, it chases me down, fights till I'm found, leads to 99. I couldn't earn it, I don't deserve it, but still you give yourself. Jesus, we are so grateful to you for who you are. You're so beautiful, but that's your ministry. You come to those dark places with your light, that you tear down the walls so that we can see you, that we can move forward, we can have a hope. There's nothing too hard for you. I just thank you for the ways you're at work in each and every one of our lives and our families already, in our workplaces, in this city. And we just want to partner with you in your mission, God. Lord, I ask that you would just anoint Garen's words with your truth and your spirit and your power this morning, that it would be your seed falling on our hearts, and our hearts would be good soil to accept your word. Rejoice in it and let it produce the fruit that you have in mind for us, that we could look more like you, Jesus. It's in your name we pray. Amen. You can be seated.
Welcome, everybody. Good to see you. If you're visiting, we had several visitors last service, but if you're here visiting for the first time this morning, we want to welcome you to 12th Avenue Baptist Church. I still remember what you guys know, I didn't grow up in church. The first time I was in a church, felt I was pretty scared the first time. So if you're here and this is like, you haven't done this in a while, that's a brave act. We appreciate it. We would love to partner with you on your journey to knowing God and Jesus. And so if you're here and would like to do that, like I think I want to hang around this community a little bit. If people follow Jesus, you can go to the information booth afterwards. We'd love to get your information and get you something, a small gift. So glad to have you this morning. Really special day, a special week. It is Easter is next week, so this is what would be called Passion Week or Holy Week. And we've got several things that we're doing this week. One thing we're doing is we've done this every time, the whole time I've been here. It is new and improved. But it's a little booklet that if you will pick one up on your way out, because this is all about Jesus dies on Friday for my sin, right? To bring me into a relationship with himself. Raises from the dead on Sunday, but it's my sin that took him to the cross. And so this week, what it does is if you'll do this, each day it will take you through the Gospel of Matthew from his arrest, through his trial, up through his crucifixion and resurrection. Each day you read a little bit of that. There is a passage of scripture under it that talks about what scripture says about our sin, for a chance for me to reflect on my own heart and my sin that took him to the cross and some other stuff. So you could grab one of those on the way out. It's just a way to be in the Word this week to really be reflecting on these events. On Thursday, we're going to have what's called Monday Thursday. I still can never remember what that means. I'm not used to those big religious words. That's okay. Essentially, we're going to celebrate the night that Jesus had his last supper with his disciples, the night before he died on a cross. And so we'll gather here and do that. So we'd love to have you come. We'll have to do a short reflection and take communion. And then on Friday, we're going to have the journey to the cross. We've done that for several years here. And we always have a large number of people that come to that, minimum 120 every year. And we just have things set up around this room that walk you through his arrest, his betrayal, his arrest, different things. And there's a booklet to reflect, and it's always very moving for me. I do not come to that without God speaking to me in a very powerful way. I have sometimes sat in here on that day and just prayed over the space and people. And trust me, I'm not just sitting and looking at people watching, okay? But I just noticed that people that come in here, it tends to be a very moving, touching experience. So if you've done it, come back. You know, if you haven't, come Friday between 8 a.m., 8 p.m. I think you'll find it to be very impactful. And then Sunday, we celebrate Jesus' resurrection from the dead. We'll have sunrise service at 7:30 outside if it's warm, if it's chilly. I promise we'll come in here. We'll have breakfast afterwards, if those of you who want to do that, biscuits and gravy every year, and Easter eggs, little jelly beans for the kids on the tables, and for people like me who have a sweet tooth. And then we'll have the Easter celebration. We have in the back the cards that have, you know, the explanation, all this, but I challenge you, take one of these home, look it over so you know the schedule, but then I want you to be in prayer of one person, just one person you can give this to, who maybe has asked you questions, has shown a little bit of interest in spiritual things, but has never stepped into a church maybe, or has been a long time, and just say, hey, why don't you come Easter? I'm going to talk about a very profound thing that happened after Jesus' resurrection. We will talk about the good news of Jesus, I promise you that. And it's always a chance for people to hear the good news that I'm going to talk about today, actually. And so please invite some people to come next week. There's always people willing to show up on Christmas Eve and on Easter that they won't any other week. And so it's just a good chance to let them hear the good news of Jesus, because it's good news. It's good news. I grew up my whole life thinking Jesus was bad news and religion was bad news. You know that? And then I found out it's good news. The greatest news ever. Changed my life. So we want people to encounter him. So I want to take a minute and take a time of prayer. We always pause, for our generosity time, just to remember that part of our worship is not just singing, but in giving, because we're going to see today, Jesus gave everything for me. And so it's nothing for me to be able to sacrifice and give of what he has given me back to him for the advancement of his kingdom among all nations. I don't have the flags to point to this week. We'll have them back soon. But you're generous people. Let us continue to live in that, because Jesus says it is more blessed to give than to receive. That's true. The more you live into it, the more you know that. We want to take a minute and pray. I know there are probably heavy hearts that came in here today. People, you've had a bad week. Something's going on in your life. Offer that to him. Talk to him about it. But I also would like you to take this minute to pray. And we're going to be in a significant text of Scripture today. One of my favorite stories in the life of Jesus. It's very significant. It's profound that we would even have our hearts open to hear what Jesus and the Lord wants to say to us through that. So can we do that? Can we do that together? So let's take a minute and go to the Lord in prayer. Lord, we come to your word now. We are going to read a story of you, of a significant thing that you did. We really open ourselves up to it. So Holy Spirit, would you please speak to us? You know our need. You know what we need to hear. I pray that you would touch us in the way that you so desire. And pray this in the name of in Jesus, our Lord and Savior. And all of God's people said, amen. Okay, I'm going to have Nathan Lee come up. And he is going to read our scripture reading. It is in Matthew 21, if you would turn there. Again, to me, one of the most powerful stories in the whole life of Jesus. So if you'd open your Bible to Matthew 21, we're going to be in verses 1 to 11. He's going to be reading out of the NIV.
As they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethphage on the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and at once you will find a donkey tied there, with her colt by her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, say that the Lord needs them, and he will send them right away." This took place to fulfill what was spoken through the prophet. "Say to the daughter of Zion, see, your king comes to you, gentle and riding on a donkey, and on a colt, the foal of a donkey." The disciples went and did as Jesus had instructed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and placed their cloaks on them for Jesus to sit on. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, while others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. The crowds that went ahead of him and those that followed shouted, "Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord! Hosanna in the highest heaven!" When Jesus entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred and asked, "Who is this?" The crowds answered, "This is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth in Galilee."
This is the word of the Lord. Amen. Amen. Thank you, Nathan, for doing that. I think one of the most famous things of Jesus' life, even if you're like me and didn't grow up in church, you knew this story, right? You'd heard of this, you knew about it. I didn't know much about what it meant. And I really want to dig into it because I really find it to be one of the most profound stories of his life. Today, we're doing it because today is Palm Sunday. Today is the day that Jesus would have entered into Jerusalem. So it literally would have been on this day. 5 days before his crucifixion. 5 days before he goes to the cross. And this morning, I want to really look into this event. It is so important. It's in all four Gospels. That's how important it is. And an event, in my humble opinion, that is wrongly called the triumphal entry. And that's in my humble opinion. I think you'll see why I think that as we go through the story. Let me do a little bit of background setup. The occasion for this coming, his coming to Jerusalem, is to celebrate the Feast of Passover. Passover was one of the three most important festivals in Jewish culture for them. But it was the single most important holiday because it was the day they celebrated their liberation from bondage, from Egypt as a nation. And this holiday was so important to them. I don't think we can grasp how important. So important, it was almost like if you took Christmas Day and put the Super Bowl inside of it and 4th of July, that's how big and significant it was, okay? It was a big deal to them. All Jewish males were required to be in Jerusalem for this week, and most of them would bring their whole families with them. We know from history, from stuff, that Jerusalem at this time was about 80,000 to 100,000 people. That on this day, on Palm Sunday, the city would swell to more than 10 times, usually, that population. So there were at least probably 1 million people that were in the city on this day. Josephus wrote in AD 65, about 30 years after this, that there were 3 million people in Jerusalem for Passover. And as a result, the Roman governor, Pilate, Pontius Pilate in this case, would come down from his capital in Caesarea up on the coast. Like if this is Israel up on the coast, he would come down in Jerusalem. He would bring thousands of troops because of the number of the people that were here. I want to set it up just a little bit more. Several days before this, Jesus had walked the treacherous valley road from Jericho through the desert wilderness of Judea up to the village, a very small village of Bethany, and there he had raised Lazarus just a few days before this, raised him from the dead. I mean, as you can see, it was a very rugged walk from Jericho, a journey about 17 miles. This photo was taken a little over 100 years ago when it was still actually, you can walk it today. It's almost the same. That journey of 17 miles has an elevation gain of 3,500 feet. I mean, when I climb a 14er, that's what I'm doing. I'm going from 10 to 14 usually. That's a long haul. And as you can see, that road from Jericho, it came into Jerusalem from the east. You would first come into Bethany, where he raised Lazarus from the dead. You would come to Bethphage, which we just read about. You would top the Mount of Olives. You would go down the Mount of Olives into the Kidron Valley and back up into Jerusalem. From that top of the Mount of Olives, it's about 300 feet above Jerusalem. And when you're up there, even to this day, I mean, I've been there. You have an amazing view down into the old city. And that whole Temple Mount is right down below you. So, beginning in verse 1, it says, as they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethphage on the Mount of Olives, and I'm going to put on the brakes. You know, I do this sometimes. I'm going to put on the brakes there because I want to say a little more. As you can see, Bethphage is located closer to Jerusalem than Bethany. Bethany is where Jesus spent a lot of this last week. He would go there almost every evening. It was about 2 miles from Jerusalem on the backside of the Mount of Olives. Bethphage was a little less than a mile from Jerusalem and actually was within a Sabbath day's journey of Jerusalem. I won't give you all the significance of that, but you could essentially, you could walk from Bethphage into Jerusalem without violating the Jewish Sabbath laws that they had created. And as such, Bethphage was officially a part of Jerusalem, and it was the outer city limit of the city. When you came to Bethphage, you were entering into Jerusalem. So back to the end of verse 1. Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, go to the village ahead of you, and at once you will find a donkey tied there with her colt by her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, say that the Lord needs them, and he will send them right away. Now, the first time you read this, you're like, it almost seems like Jesus is stealing somebody's donkeys, right? Absconding with their property. What really is most likely is that he had prearranged this with some people, some individuals. We already know from John's gospel that Jesus had very close friends in Bethany, and Bethany and Bethphage were very close to each other. We know from John's gospel that Jesus came to Jerusalem on multiple occasions, and he got to know people there. So it's likely he had made an acquaintance with this family and had already talked to them that at some point he's going to need their donkeys. And just the same way that we're told in the Gospel of Mark that Jesus had prearranged the meeting with the people for the upper room. So look at verse 4. This took place to fulfill what was spoken through the prophet. Say to daughter Zion, see your king comes to you, gentle and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey. This is the 9th of 10 prophecies that Matthew references in his gospel, messianic prophecies specifically about Jesus. Only Matthew and John reference this prophecy because they're the two gospels that were written primarily to a Jewish audience. Mark and Luke were written more to Romans. They wouldn't be interested in it, wouldn't even know that. The opening words, say to daughter Zion, are taken from Isaiah 62:11. The rest of the words are taken from Zechariah 9:9, which was considered by the rabbis of that time to be a messianic prophecy. Now, before moving on, I need you to know something really significant that John says. It's very important in his gospel about this. In John 12:16, here's what he says. He references this prophecy in Zechariah, and then he says, at first his disciples did not understand this. Only after Jesus was glorified did they realize the connection between what Jesus did and this messianic prophecy of Zechariah 9:9. So on that day, I want you to know, nobody made a connection with that prophecy and what was happening. Nobody. His disciples, nobody in the crowd. And in a minute, I'm going to tell you why they didn't connect the two. Verse 6, the disciples went and did as Jesus had instructed them. They brought the donkey and the colt, and they placed their cloaks on them for Jesus to sit on. Both Mark and Luke tell us that this colt had never been ridden, and that explains why Matthew is the one who has the detail that they brought both, the mother and the colt, because for a colt to be ridden the first time, it needed its mother there, right, to provide that sense of security, especially as raucous as this crowd is. They needed to have both there. Verse 8, a very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, while others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. John tells us the branches were palm branches. I think if you know anything about this story, you have that image in your mind, right? I mean, it's up on this. This region of Judea was and is still known for its date palms. In some festivals, like the Feast of Tabernacles or the Feast of Temporary Shelters, which we looked at in Nehemiah, do you remember that? They would cut large palm branches from Jericho and bring up for that festival, because they were much larger, Jericho being called the City of Palms. But here in the text, it tells us these are just more branches cut off locally that are much smaller, that they're using, ones from around Jerusalem. But what Matthew wants us to realize is this was a really huge crowd. This was a huge crowd. A very large crowd, in his words. Pilgrims coming to that city would typically be welcomed by people of the city while coming out and welcoming them in. So that's why Matthew, he starts the next verse in verse 9 by telling us there were crowds ahead of him, which would have been the people of Jerusalem coming out to meet the pilgrims. And there were crowds behind him, locally, likely those coming in with him from the countryside, right? From all over the country. So it's almost a picture of him being swept along in the sea of people. And in verse 9, we're told, it says, they shouted, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest heaven. If you looked at this in the Greek, the verb tense for shouted means they were saying this repeatedly, over and over and over again. It wasn't just one time they were saying it. This thing they're saying is actually, they're quoting Psalm 118, 25 to 26. Psalms 113 to 118 are called the halal psalms, which just means praise psalms. Praise is what halal means. And these six psalms were sung regularly during Passover season. So these words of Psalm 118, 25 to 26 would have been fresh in their ears. And as the text says, they're shouting out, Hosanna to the Son of David, Hosanna in the highest. I don't know what you think that means, but for a long time, I just thought Hosanna meant praise the Lord. That's just what I assumed it meant. But it doesn't mean that. Hosanna is the Greek transliteration of the Hebrew. Is it up there? Of the Hebrew. Here it comes. Hoshiana. Can you say Hoshiana? Yeah, wow, Hebrew. That's amazing. Hoshiana. Hoshiana means please save us. Save us now, or help us, please. It is a cry to God to be saved or delivered. Okay, but whatever the case, I think the picture is clear that Matthew's giving us is there's a lot of excitement going on. Okay, a lot of shouting, a lot going on. So verse 10, when Jesus entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred, and they asked, who is this? And the crowds answered, this is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth in Galilee. I mean, his entrance into the city and all the clamor, the attention that it attracted, he says it stirred up the city. And I want you to know, in my opinion, those are really weak words, stirred up. The Greek word that's behind that is the word from which we get our word seismic, referencing an earthquake, okay, an earthquake. In other words, his entry into the city and the crowd's reaction to it, it sent shockwaves literally throughout the city. The whole city was shaken up because of what's happening here. That's very strong language. The last time that the city experienced this kind of seismic event, these kind of shockwaves through the whole city, was in Matthew's gospel in chapter 2, where he uses the exact same word of when the magi from the east, the kings from the east, come into the city and show up, and they say, we're here because your king has been born, and it says it sent shockwaves through the whole city, okay? So that's the same word. That's the other time that happened in this city in recent history. And we're told the question on everybody's mind is this, who is this man? Who is this man? And as we've already noted, Jesus had been in Jerusalem before. He had done miracles and teaching there. But he was not as well known there as he was in Galilee. 90% of his ministry was in Galilee. He was very well known there. There would have been people in the city from other regions in Judea, probably to the south, to the east, who maybe had heard his name or heard of him, but maybe had heard nothing. And so they were legitimately asking, there were people legitimately saying, who is this? Who is this that's creating this seismic event? By the way, Matthew wants you as a reader to ask this same question when you read his gospel. Who is this man? In fact, all the gospels want you to ask that question. Who is this man? If you're here today, we have a number of people that are here who are on a journey towards Jesus, are still trying to figure out who he is. And if that's you, I have in the back on the way out, I have the Gospel of Mark. It's written in the Message, which is a paraphrase of the Bible. It's not a translation. Mark, and it's got some passages from Romans. But if you would like to just sit down and read through Mark in just one short sitting in an evening, I encourage you to grab one of these on the way out if you're exploring for Jesus. If you're here and you know him, if you want one of these, come ask me. I will get you one. But let's leave those for people that are exploring, okay? But I really challenge you, read Mark and ask the question, who is this man? And the answer they received that day was this. This is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth in Galilee. Now, would you not agree there is much more going on here than what I led on to, right? I kind of skimmed over that, gave you a few important things. I want you to know there is a lot going on. There are a lot of very powerful messianic overtones that are going on here. The Messiah being the long-awaited Savior, the deliverer, the messianic king who is descended from King David, who would come, they believed, fully and finally deliver them from all of the pagan, oppressive Gentile nations, who would finally bring in God's new creation, who would set up his final and full kingdom. They've been waiting for this guy for years. And I want to point out all the messianic references that are going on here, okay? I want to point out the messianic references. First, the Mount of Olives is mentioned in verse 1. It is very, very significant. In Zechariah 14:4, a prophecy about Messiah said, when Messiah came, he would come on the Mount of Olives, and he would come down into Jerusalem. So that was their expectation of Messiah. During this festival, once the pilgrims hit Bethphage, the city limits of Jerusalem, if they were riding an animal there, they had to get off the animal. You were only allowed to walk in because of the kind of the holy nature of this festival in their mind. You had to dismount. Yet Jesus climbs on a donkey in verse 7. He climbs on a donkey. And in ancient culture, I mean, you don't have to think about this too much to figure it out. A victorious king would always enter a city on his trusty steed, right? That's how a king always, a victor especially. So I want you to know this action is clearly communicating to everybody that Jesus is coming as king, okay? It has very clear messianic implications. Everybody would have noticed him climbing up on something like that. And as I've already mentioned, Jesus riding on the donkey was clearly messianic. It had been predicted in Zechariah 9. And that's why Matthew points it out in verses 4 to 5. But as I said, and I want you to remember this, that nobody that day connected him getting on the donkey to Zechariah 9. Nobody made that connection. Nobody. Okay? More in a minute on that. In verse 8, they're waving palm branches and they're throwing them down in front of him along with their outer cloaks. And again, in ancient times, but especially in this Middle Eastern region, particularly in this area, when a king entered into a city, people would create a red carpet for them. They would throw palm branches in front of a coming king, perhaps their cloaks, flowers, or other things to create that red carpet. And we don't do that in our culture, but I think we all know what that looks like when it's happening, right? We all know what that looks like. And they're shouting out repeatedly, Hosanna to the Son of David. Hosanna to the Son of David. I want you to know those words, Son of David, do not occur in that psalm. They're adding that. That's their addition to that. It is not in that psalm. And that tells us a lot. That tells us a lot. Son of David was a messianic title. It was the title for the Messiah they expected to come, that in his kingly rule is the descendant of David. And so in other words, here's what they're doing. They are proclaiming Jesus as the messianic Davidic king, the one they've long awaited for. That's what they're doing when they add that to this. And you can clearly see this in Mark, where he records this, that they were saying, blessed is the coming kingdom of our father David. Clearly, they thought he was the messianic king. And then in verse 10, we see Jesus called the prophet from Nazareth in Galilee. In the Greek, it's super clear. The prophet. The prophet. And that's important because in Deuteronomy 18:18, God had told Moses that when Messiah came, he would be the ultimate prophet. And so when the Messiah came, they knew he would be a teacher. They knew he'd be a teacher and a prophet. So this proclamation is, this is Messiah. This is Deuteronomy 18:18 happening. So do you see what's going on here? Jesus is clearly being honored and proclaimed as the messianic king, as Israel's deliverer, as the Messiah. That's what is happening here. You know, at this time in the nation's history, messianic expectation was running very high. It was running at a fever pitch, we know actually from historical documents. The people were sick and tired of hundreds of years of living under the boot of pagan empires who ruled and controlled them, right? And they were desperately longing for Messiah to come and set them free from their Roman oppressors. And also at this time, we know from historical documents that there was this very high expectation that the prophecy about the Messiah coming in Daniel 9, 24 to 26, that time, if you did the math on it, that time was really close. So they're expecting Messiah to show up at any moment, all right? And this event happens at Passover. Again, the feast that's all about freedom and liberation from oppressors. That's what this feast is all about, okay? Do you see the environment that this is happening in? I want you to know that William Wallace and any good Scot would have loved this holiday that's all about freedom, okay? And that most of you won't even understand what I'm saying, but for those of you who have the Garen bingo card for my sermons, I don't very often put up the Scottish thing up there, so you can check that one off today. Let me get past that, though. Let me get back to what we're doing. I just want you to know the hopes for the restoration of the Davidic kingdom, they ran high at Passover every year. In fact, at this time in history, we know from rabbinic literature that when Passover came, they would keep the door to the temple open, hoping the Messiah would come that year during Passover. And this nationalistic fervor was so strong in the time of Jesus, it had spilled over into multiple riots in the years leading up to this during Passover. And that's why Pilate brought so many extra troops into Jerusalem, was to quell the riots that had been happening. This huge nationalistic fervor was going on. But there's even more that's going on here. I want to tell you some important Jewish history. I love history, so. In 332 BC, Alexander the Great had conquered Judea. He had taken it over by conquering the Persians when we did Nehemiah. They were controlled by the Persians. They'd been controlled by the Babylonians, by the Persians. When Alexander came, they'd been controlled by those 10 empires for 250 years. 250 years. Now Alexander comes, and now they're under his control. In 170 BC, you know, Alexander dies, and his kingdom gets split into four. One of them was the Seleucid Empire. The Seleucid Empire was in that area of Judea, and in 175, the Seleucid Emperor Antiochus Epiphanes IV took power, and he was a total tyrant. Ruled with an iron fist. He went in the Jerusalem temple. He sacrificed a pig on the altar in the temple. The most desecrating thing you can do for a Jewish person. They hated him. And so in 167 BC, the Maccabees began their famous Jewish revolt against him. Eventually, they were successful. And on December 14th of 164 BC, Judas Maccabee came into Jerusalem, liberated the city, entered into Jerusalem. That's where the Jewish holiday Hanukkah comes from, is from that liberation from Antiochus Epiphanes. And I want you to know, he victoriously and triumphantly entered the city. He went to the temple and ritually cleansed it, and then he made his brother Jonathan the high priest over the temple. Now, when he entered the city, Judas Maccabee, the people of the city waved palm branches to welcome him. In fact, here's how a historical document from that time records that event. Here's what it says. The Jews entered the city with praise and palm branches and with hymns and songs because a great enemy had been crushed and removed from Israel. Does that not sound really familiar to what's happening on this day for Jesus? I want you to know this event, this December 14th, was huge to the Jewish people. It was their 4th of July. And with the triumph of the Maccabees, and because of what happened that day with the waving of the palm branches and the welcoming of him, the palm branch became the symbol of the Jewish nation and of Jewish liberation movements after that. Much like the stars and stripes is the symbol of our liberation and freedom, right? It's our national symbol, or the eagle. The palm branch is the symbol for the Jewish people. So starting with the Maccabees, the palm branch began to appear on all of their coins. On all their coins. Even when the Romans came in, they made extra coins with palm branches, okay, because of the longing to be set free. Sadly, though, the rule of the Maccabeans and the empire they created only lasted about 100 years, and then the Romans came in 63 BC. And now they're slaves again in their own country. I mean, in Egypt, they're slaves in another country. Here they're in their own country, and they're in bondage to another empire. So here's what I want you to see, that the crowd's use of palm branches, it is obviously hearkening back to that Maccabean revolution and to hit that triumph and the entrance of Judas Maccabees into the city. And it clearly shows that in their minds, when they're looking at Jesus that day, they're thinking of him in revolutionary terms as that warrior king Messiah, the conquering Messiah, finally coming. And when they repeatedly chanted Hosanna to the Son of David, that's not just, they're just quoting a religious scripture from their memory from Awana. It's not just a religious thing. By that time, Hosanna had become a political chant for liberation. They're saying to Jesus, here's what they're saying on that day. They're saying, Jesus, deliver us from the Roman Empire and these oppressors of ours. Just as Moses delivered our people from Egypt, you deliver us from Rome. Please liberate us. Set us free, Jesus. That's what they're saying in this cry. So do you see what this whole thing is in the minds of the Jewish people that day when he gets on that donkey, okay? It was a royal entrance procession. That's what it meant to them. And it was the coronation procession of the Messiah King, the royal Messiah. Their deliverer they've been waiting for years has finally come. He's going to finally come and overthrow the Roman Empire, get rid of Rome and Caesar, the whole bunch. They wanted Jesus to proclaim himself as king. That's what they wanted. To establish the messianic kingdom that would overthrow all the kings of the world, especially the wicked evil empire of Rome. And on that day, their intent was to make a political Messiah of Jesus. I want you to know that. Their intent was to make a political Messiah of Jesus on that day. But here's what I love about this story. Jesus would have none of it. He would have none of it. Yes, he was intentionally entering into Jerusalem that day. He was doing messianic things. Up to this point in his ministry, when he would do miracles, he would frequently tell people, don't tell people what I did for you. Don't tell people who I am, but not on this day. And all through his ministry, everywhere Jesus went, he walked. He walked everywhere, but not on this day. On this day, he mounted a royal steed, so to speak, okay? In Bethphage, at the city limits of Jerusalem, on the Mount of Olives, at Passover, and he rode into the city. He rode into the city. He was intentionally presenting himself that day as Israel's Messiah. There is no question about that. But if they had paid attention to the single most important detail of what he was doing, the single most important detail, that was connected to a messianic prophecy in Zechariah 9, something which that day nobody connected, nobody made the connection. They would have known he was not coming as the warrior messianic king, but rather he was coming as the suffering servant of Isaac. Isaiah 53, he's coming as a suffering servant. He's not coming as Caesar, of the great Roman king. That's not what he's doing. This story changed my life. Military heroes, victorious conquering kings always come on horses, right? Always come on horses. Jesus rides a donkey, a lowly, simple animal that's an animal of burden. I mean, look at it. Right? Look at it. When we used to take international students to Bear Trap over Christmas, we would always take them. One of the things we'd do is we'd take them to a ranch just a short distance away down the mountain where they had horses, and we'd let the students ride horses. Most had never ridden the horses. To ride the horses in the snow in the Colorado mountains, there's nothing like it. And you know a horse. They're majestic, right? They're powerful. They're amazing. And this place that had these horses, all these horses, they also had a little donkey that just hung around that was their little pet. And the students always loved getting on the horse, getting their picture with the horses, but the students also loved getting their picture with the donkey. It was kind of funny. But we'd get on the horses, and we'd start riding out of the camp to go into the mountains and in the forest, just so beautiful. And you're on this powerful steed, right? And you're doing this, and that donkey would follow us to the edge of their property. And I don't know if you've ever seen a donkey next to a horse. I mean, when you're up on top of one, it's this itty-bitty, it's almost comical. And they run with little itty-bitty steps, kind of, you know, and it's almost comical to look at them. It's funny to see that kind of thing, all right? That's why one commentator says a king on an ass is a contradiction in terms. Kings don't come on donkeys. And specifically, he chose the colt of a donkey. Again, look at that. And that's kind of what the donkey looked like that was there. That's what he chose to ride in. His actions were radically contrasting with those of a military victor. But these people, they were so caught up in their messianic expectations of him that no one took notice of the kind of animal that he was on. Nobody noticed it, right? And that he was fulfilling a prophecy in what he was writing. They totally missed it. His followers missed it. Everybody missed it that day. And that's why John said it wasn't until after his resurrection that his followers were like, oh my goodness, that was Zechariah 9 happening. Because nobody saw it that day. Because all they could think about was military victory over their oppressors. That's all they could think about. So Jesus, yes, he was coming as king. He was coming as king. But he was defining his kingship through Zechariah 9:9. That's how he was defining his kingship. Not the commonly expected role of a king, coming with great military power, right? With pomp and circumstance, as a conquering victor. Not at all. He came gentle and riding on a donkey. That's how he came. He came in humility and in weakness. That's how he came. And in so doing, he was not just redefining his kingship. He was redefining messiahship for them. That he was not coming as the warrior messiah. He wasn't coming as the political military conqueror of the Roman Empire that the crowds wanted. He was coming as the Prince of Peace. That's how he was coming. If they had thought about it, they knew the scripture. If they had made the connection of Zechariah 9:9 to what he was doing, if they'd done that, they would have known verse 10 of Zechariah 9 of the rest of that prophecy, which says this, that he will take away the chariots from Ephraim, the war horses from Jerusalem, the battle bow, he's going to break it, right? He will proclaim peace to the nations. His rule will extend from sea to sea to the ends of the earth. Does that language not really sound familiar? Is that not Great Commission language? Is that not Acts 1:8 language of taking the good news of Jesus to the nations, not to conquer them, but to proclaim that Jesus, our Lord, the true King, has come to save us, right? They would have known that if they had thought about it. I want you to know this morning that he was resoundingly on that day renouncing their revolutionary aspirations and their revolutionary ideas about Messiah. Clearly he was doing that. And here's the other thing they missed in all of their political messianic fervor. Here's the other thing they missed. That this day, the day he entered Jerusalem, was Lamb Selection Day. This was the day from Exodus 12. That every family selected the lamb that they would sacrifice on Passover. This is the day that Jesus comes, on Lamb Selection Day. It's the day that the Father is saying, I've chosen my lamb. So riding that day on that donkey was not a military victor. Writing that day on that donkey was, in the words of Paul in 1 Corinthians, our Passover lamb. In the words of John the Baptist, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. That's who was on the back of that donkey that day. Jesus wasn't coming as the warrior Messiah to win a victory in the battlefield. He was coming as the suffering Messiah, as the Lamb of God to give his life on the cross. That's why he was coming, and that's how he was coming. And sadly, nobody noticed. They didn't notice the donkey. Nobody noticed the day. Here's why I love this story. That in all of this, Jesus is subverting their expectations. He's good at that, isn't he? How many of my expectations of what God is or what he should do or what he should be or the timing, how often does he subvert my expectations? And I would say, yes, Jesus is portraying himself as Messiah and as the King. So make no mistake about that. But in the way that he comes, I want you to know he's redefining kingship and messiahship and the significance of them. The deliverance, when they said, Hoshiana, the deliverance they were looking for and they were crying out for was the military political kind. That's what they were crying out for. Because this is the kind of deliverance people always seek, right? People are constantly, I don't care what age, what culture, they're looking for a political savior. That's who people are always looking for. Who's going to fix our country? That guy, right? That political savior. That's what people always look for. But I want you to know that the deliverance that day they were not crying out for was the true kind of deliverance, which is spiritual deliverance from my sin. That's the deliverance they had no clue was going on. That kind of deliverance. They were only thinking in terms of the Messiah as a conquering king. They didn't even have a category in their mind for the real reason that he was coming. And that he was coming as the suffering servant whose death would bring salvation, not from Rome, not from any empire or oppressor, but from the two great enemies of sin and of Satan. That's who he was coming to bring deliverance from. And you know what? Once the people in that city realized that he wasn't about what they thought, well, 5 days after this, those same people are crying out, crucify him. Crucify him. Crucify him. You see, this was not the triumphal entry they thought. It was, to me, it was the non-triumphal entry. And that Jesus was saying, my kingship, you want to know what my kingship is? It's a kingship of servanthood. It's a kingship of sacrifice that I am establishing my rule on earth, coming as a lamb, bringing salvation through suffering and dying. Through suffering and dying. And he was saying, essentially, this is how I usher in my kingdom, the upside down kingdom. And by the way, because I've been thinking about me and about us, if we want to work with Jesus to usher in his kingdom into our neighborhoods, into our city, into our nation, into our world, the way he came, that is the way that we usher in his kingdom, by bringing the good news of Jesus to people who do not know him, right? People we love, that we care about, that's how we usher in his kingdom. Because the thing that people desperately need is not a political savior. People need salvation from their sin and their enslavement to their sin and the separation it brings from God. That's the deliverance that people need, right? That's the human problem. Do you know what people need? I mean, you know this, most of you. Do you know what people need? They need Jesus, the Savior and the Lord. That's who they need. The one that if they will receive him, they will receive forgiveness of their sins. They will receive an eternal relationship with the Father. They will receive, the Holy Spirit will come into them, and the promise is give them a new heart and begin to change them from the inside out, and that same Spirit will give them the mind of Christ and will start changing their worldview and the way they look at the world. Okay, the way they look at the world. That is what people need. That's what people need. And here's my cry. Can we be about that? Can we be about the proclamation of the good news of Jesus? Can that be our focus? Can that be the thing that is most important to us with everything and how we're trying to approach the people around us? That's how I take it. And that's why I always will be committed to sharing the good news of Jesus with people around me, because that's what people need. That's what people need. They don't need what they think or what they expect. They need him, the Lamb of God. Okay. We want to celebrate Palm Sunday. Can we do that? It's kind of traditional, like on a day like this, to have children come in and wave palm branches, kind of like what's happening then, and we're going to do that. I want you to stay seated so we can kind of see them, but if the worship team would come up, we're gonna sing a song and have the kids come up. We're gonna worship our Lord and our King, and enjoy this with the children, and then we're gonna kind of wrap up with worship right after that. So, stay seated now. In a minute, I will invite you to stand.
Hallelujah! 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 Praise ye the Lord. Hallelujah! 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 Praise ye the Lord. Praise ye the Lord. Hallelujah! Praise ye the Lord. Hallelujah! Praise ye the Lord. Hallelujah! Praise ye the Lord. Hallelujah, 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 praise ye the Lord. Hallelujah, hallelujah. hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Praise ye the Lord. Praise ye the Lord. Hallelujah. 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 Praise ye the Lord. Hallelujah. 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 Praise ye the Lord. Praise ye the Lord. Hallelujah. 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 Praise ye the Lord. Hallelujah. 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 Praise ye the Lord. Praise ye the Lord. Hallelujah. Praise ye the Lord. Hallelujah. Praise ye the Lord. Hallelujah. Praise ye the Lord.
I want to invite you all to stand as the kids kind of parade on out. We'll sing them out.
Hallelujah, 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 praise ye the Lord. Hallelujah, 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 praise ye the Lord. Praise ye the Lord, hallelujah, praise ye the Lord, hallelujah, praise ye the Lord, hallelujah, praise ye the Lord.
Let's give our kids a hand. Thank you, guys.
The Lamb, you are holy.
said to that? Amen. Are you not thankful that Jesus didn't come as a political revolutionary and that he came as the Lamb to pay for my sin and to take the weight of the guilt of that off of my back and to bring me into his relationship with him? Are you not thankful that's how he came? Okay, again, if you're here as you're leaving, if you're like, Jesus is new or you're kind of seeking him, grab a gospel mark on the way out. Sit down this week and read through it. Would love to see you guys back here Easter. Bring a friend with you. We're going to celebrate the resurrection of the crucified Lamb, resurrection of him from the dead, conquering sin and Satan and the grave. So, all right, let me pray us out. Father, thank you for this story. Thank you that you, Jesus, you didn't come as a warrior on a horse, but you came as a lamb on a donkey. And that you took the price of my sin to the cross to offer me forgiveness and relationship with you. I am eternally grateful. You have changed my life. I thank you that you totally subverted everything they thought about you and that you were who you are. We worship you. Worthy are you, the Lamb. And we pray this in the name of Jesus, the Lamb of God. Amen. All right, 12th, you are sent.